Hi everyone. Okay, welcome to our first talk of the series in fall semester. So again, in case there are some new audience here, this talk series will be given by the awardees of NCU Delta Young Astronomer Lectureship, which was founded by the National Central University and Delta Electronics Foundation to, you know, recognize young scholars who have made outstanding contributions in this field. So each year the awardee will be invited to Taiwan to interact with the local astronomers and the public. And the first award was given in 2012. And actually the original plan for this year was to invite all of the previous awardees to, you know, come back to Taiwan. But unfortunately we have to make this event online due to the pandemic. So our speaker today is Dr. Jean-Baptiste Vanson from DLR, Institute of Planetary Research. It's our great pleasure to have him here. Dr. Vanson received this award in 2017, and he's a world expert in studying small bodies such as comets and asteroids. And I think he has great contributions for example, understanding the surface structure of active comets and the theoretical interpretations of the underlying mechanisms. And he has also joined many important space missions, such as the famous Rosetta mission to study the comet 67P. And I believe he has written many high profile papers on this fantastic object. So today the title of his talk is Next Frontiers in Exploration of Asteroids and Comets. So just a few announcements before we start. Please mute yourself during the talk. If you have any questions or comments, please leave them in the chat box anytime you want. We will come back to those questions in the middle of the talk or during the Q&A session after talk. So, okay, Jean-Baptiste, I will let you take this away if you're ready.
Okay.
I can try to, yeah, okay, it's already in full screen. I can see it clearly.
Yeah, it's already in full screen.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you for the introduction, and please interrupt me anytime if there are some technical issues or if you don't hear me well or if you don't see the slide. So yeah, thank you very much for having me today to give this talk, and also for giving me this award a few years ago. So thanks a lot to NCU and to the Delta Foundation for that. So yeah, you gave me the opportunity to visit Taiwan and to have many interesting discussions with my friends and colleagues there at NCU and in many other places. And I wish I could be there today to speak to you face to face and to enjoy then, I don't know, good food in the night market in Taipei or elsewhere. But hopefully we can do that again in the coming years. And this reminds me, I wanted to do something. Yeah, I will put as a virtual background a picture I took from the Lulin Observatory so I can pretend that I'm in Taiwan today. So for this talk, I decided to focus on very positive things and some exciting things that are happening in the field of exploration of small bodies, asteroids and comets. And to look at the future and to try to encourage maybe younger people or new generation of students and scientists to join this field and to work with us on trying to understand this fascinating object of our solar system. And last time I was in Taiwan, I gave several lectures about the Rosetta mission. That is the background of my title slide here. Because we had just finished the mission and we had so much data, and we are actually still working on this data. And Professor Ip has just published a new paper on the looking at the erosion of the comet. And there is still so much to do. But of course, there is also the question of what comes next after the Rosetta mission. What are the questions that we could not answer, and what are the next space missions we need in order to address these questions? And this is what I want to talk about today. So I will start first with some general statements. to give you a bit of an idea of the field if you're not too familiar with that. So on this slide, you see pictures of almost all the asteroids and comets that have been observed by space missions up to now. There are a few missing. The last ones from the last couple of years are missing, but these are about 20 objects that we have visited with spacecraft. And why do we care about these objects? Well, in our current understanding, we think that asteroids and comets are somehow the leftovers from the formation of the solar system. So they are small objects, rocky and icy objects that did not manage to come together to accrete into larger planets. And this can be for many reasons. It can be because there was not enough mass available in the accretion disk where these objects were starting to form. It can be that they were too much disturbed by the gravitational pull of planets that had formed a bit earlier. It could be that they started to accrete as planets, but because of collisions, these planets broke down, and all what we see now are the debris of these collisions. But essentially, what this is telling us is that by studying asteroids and comets, we have a window into the very beginning of the solar system. And so we study these objects to try to understand how our planets have formed and also how they evolve. What are the dynamics of the solar system that are controlling the position of these objects? And this tells us about our origin, about how the planets are formed, but it's also telling us some things about later times in the history of the solar system, because these objects don't stay where they are formed, they migrate, and sometimes they impact planets. And this can lead to the transport of material from the outer solar system to the inner solar system. For instance, we are not so sure about the origin of water and organic material on our planet, but also on Mars or on Venus. And one of the hypotheses is that this material that is necessary for life to appear could have been deposited by asteroids or by comets. So that's something we are investigating. But sometimes this impact can also have very negative consequences. A giant impact can lead to a massive extinction. You're all aware of this. The most famous case would be the extinction event at the end of the Cretaceous period, 65 million years ago, during which the Chicxulub impact wiped out three quarters of life on Earth. So that's a question that comes up. What can we do if we detect that an asteroid or a comet would come towards our planet and would impact our planet? Do we have the capability to protect ourselves or protect the planet against such threat? So these are some of the topics I will discuss today. To kind of bring you up to date on what is happening in our field and what are the challenges for the next decade. So I will start with some concepts about what I call the big picture. What are the big open questions in our field after all these missions that and all this data that we have collected from previous missions? I mentioned that by studying asteroids and comets, we study the origins of the solar system. And for instance, one of the big questions is how much mass was in the accretion disk and how much mass was, so how much material was at the edge of the solar system where comets were formed. This number is important because it constrains a lot of the processes that are happening, a lot of the dynamical processes that are happening later on in the evolution of the solar system, such as the migration of the giant planets. And we believe that this is also happening on many other planetary systems. We know that many sun-like stars that where there is a planetary system forming, also have a disk of small bodies around them. And we wonder what is the contribution of these small objects to the general evolution of the system. And if it's necessary to have these small bodies forming far away from their star in order to allow the rocky planets to form closer to the star and then later have the possibility to host life. And so for that, we need to study how these objects form and especially where they form and what they are made of. And one big unknown we have at the moment is about the interior structure of these objects. We don't really know what is inside asteroids and comets, what is the distribution of density or the distribution of different type of material inside the objects. And this is very important to constrain the very early history of the formation of these objects. And that's something we hope to address with future missions. So far, we have not really been able to do that. Beyond the origins, comets and asteroids are also important for looking at the evolution of planetary systems, as I mentioned before, particularly of these objects. But we are also interested in the evolution of these objects themselves. And I will get back to this towards the end of the talk. But at the moment, I just want to say that we know that asteroids and comets are active, especially comets. They show these beautiful tails that can cover the full sky when we observe them from the Earth. And we know that this is due to the sublimation of volatile material and ices that are present on the surface or very close to the surface. But the details of this evolution is they are not very well understood. And when we look at features on asteroids and comets, it's not always obvious whether these features, the topography, for instance, whether this is something very pristine that dates from the origin of the solar system, or whether this is something that has been created by evolutionary processes. And that's something that I'm personally very much interested in, and it's one of the main topics of my work. And finally, we have the connection to habitability. So I mentioned before that comets and asteroids contain all the elements that are necessary for the creation of life. They have organic material, they have water. And maybe they brought these elements to our planet, but they can also be a danger to the planet because giant impact releases a lot of energy suddenly and can completely destroy lots of ecosystems very quickly. So asteroids and comets are important to understand this concept of habitability, because on one hand they are a positive thing, but on the other hand they can also be a danger. And looking a bit towards the future, many people think that asteroids are very relevant because they contain rare materials that would be very valuable, particularly for electronics and for all the components that we will need if we want to transition to a world where we use less fossil fuels and more electric energy. And so asteroid mining is being more and more discussed. It used to be something that was completely science fiction, but now more and more companies and space agencies are starting to get interested into this, and maybe it will become a real business in the future. So, of course, if I tell you that asteroids and comets are fascinating and that we want to study them in details, you might think that I'm a bit biased because that's my work. So it's clear that I have a special interest in that. But I'm not the only one. And what I want to show you with this slide is that almost every space agency in the world has planned a space mission that will go to a comet or an asteroid in the next 10 years. And here I show you a timeline of all the missions that are currently selected and are going to fly. There are a few more that may be extended, for instance, OSIRIS-REx and New Horizons from NASA. They are not on this plot, but they might be extended and we continue to study such objects. And there are many other proposals that are under review by different space agencies and that may also become real in the next decade. So we have something like 10 missions. It's quite impressive, and it's really, for me, it's a golden age of comets and asteroid exploration, because in the next 10 years we are going to get so much data from all of these missions, and we will be able to address scientific questions that we could not answer before. So in the next slide, I'm going to give you a quick overview of all these missions and why they are so exciting. But because this talk has to be 45 minutes, I'm going to focus mostly on two missions in which I'm very much involved. And these are HERA and Comet Interceptor. But first, we will start with a kind of tour of all the missions, so you get an idea of what is happening in this particular field. And we start, so the missions are not given in any particular order, but I try to group them by space agency mostly. So we will first start with missions from our colleagues from JAXA, from the Japanese Space Agency. As you know, they had a very successful mission called Hayabusa 2. And in the last few years, they have gone to asteroid Ryugu. They have landed on the asteroid with actually a small lander that was built by my institute, DLR. And they have collected a sample from the asteroid, actually multiple samples that were brought back to Japan last year. And the scientists from JAXA and from universities there, they are currently investigating these samples. And I'm really eager to see what they will find from these studies. But the spacecraft itself is still flying. And the mission was extended, and Hayabusa 2 is now on its way to visit or to fly by two small asteroids. I think in 2026, and the next one is maybe 2030 or 31. So the space mission is doing very well and is going to visit two additional objects over the next 10 years. Another very nice mission from JAXA is Destiny Plus, which is a technology demonstration mission that we launch very soon in 2022, and will fly by asteroid Phaeton. And Phaeton is a very peculiar asteroid because it flies very close to the sun, only 0.14 astronomical units. And it's experiencing very, very warm temperatures, and the surface is kind of shedding material. And all this dust trails behind the asteroid and is the source of the Geminids meteor shower that we can observe from the Earth. And many colleagues at NCU have worked on asteroid Phaeton, and I believe that some of you are involved in Destiny Plus. So I look forward to this mission. This is really a fantastic object that JAXA is going to investigate. And finally, the last mission on my list from JAXA is MMX. MMX is a mission that is, it means Martian Moon Explorer. It's a mission that is going to the Martian moon Phobos, and it will launch in 24, and it's going to explore the moon, map it with very, very high resolution. But it will also land. So there is a small lander that is built by the French and German space agencies that is going to land on the asteroid. Well, we don't know actually if it's an asteroid. That's one of the big questions with Phobos, whether it's an asteroid that was captured by Mars or whether it's a piece of Mars actually that was ejected during a giant impact. And so MMX will explore Phobos, but also land, collect a sample, and bring this sample back to Earth in 2029. So once again, a very, very exciting mission. Next, we have a series of American missions. Two of them are launching very soon. The first one is the Lucy mission that will actually launch at the end of next month. And that's a Discovery class mission that is going to make a tour of the Jupiter Trojans. So the Trojans are asteroids that are flying on the same orbit as Jupiter. They are gravitationally bound to Jupiter on the what we call the Lagrange points, which means there is a group that is behind Jupiter on its orbit and the other one that is in front of Jupiter, and they rotate together. And this mission is taking advantage of that and has a very interesting trajectory that will allow the spacecraft to fly through one of these groups of Trojans and then back to the Earth and then to the next Trojan group. And overall, over several years, the mission will visit 5 different objects, really sampling all the diversity of these bodies that we actually don't understand very well. We find all the different types of asteroids within the Jupiter Trojan family, and it's unclear really how they got there and how they formed and what they tell us about the dynamical evolution of Jupiter and of the solar system in this at this distance from the sun. Another mission from NASA is Psyche, which is also a discovery mission. And this is going to explore a very strange object. So if you know a bit about asteroids, we mostly have 3 types of asteroids to make a very broad classification. We have the S-type that are mostly silicate-rich. We have the C-type that are mostly carbon-rich, that are very dark, almost like comets. And then we have strange objects like the M-type, and the largest of one is asteroid Psyche, which spectrally look like very, very rich in metal, which means they are potentially pieces of the deep interior of an object that was differentiated. So if you push this to the extreme, it could be that some of these objects are actually the core, pieces of the core of a planet that started to form but did not survive and got destroyed in big collisions. And that's something we first don't really understand. And also we have no idea how these objects would look like because the material would have very different properties from what we are used to. So we are not even sure how a crater, for instance, would look like or how the regolith would be. So the surface material on such asteroid. So NASA is going to rendezvous with asteroid Psyche in 2026 and orbit around it for I think a couple of years. So they will have plenty of time to map the object and really understand what it is made of and how it came to be. And finally, the last mission from NASA that I want to mention is a very small mission. It's called Janus. It's actually 2 very tiny spacecraft, the size of a suitcase, each of them. And both will launch next year. And each of them will go to fly by a binary asteroid system. So we have 2 spacecraft that will fly by 2 different systems and 2 binary systems. So it's really a mission of 2s. Everything goes in pairs with this mission. And that's pretty exciting too. Next on my list is the Zhengke mission from the Chinese Space Agency that is supposed to launch in 2025. I don't have too many details to share about this mission at the moment, but the plan is to do first a sample return from a near Earth object, so going to a very small asteroid near the Earth, collect material and bring it back. And then with the main spacecraft, continue to the main belt and look at a main belt comet. And if you're not familiar with that, a main belt comet is it's basically an object that has the orbit of an asteroid that lives in the asteroid belt. So one could think it's an asteroid. However, it's active and it has a tail of dust. Also, we don't detect much gas, but at least dust. And it's unclear why these objects are active, and maybe they contain ice, or maybe the activity is due to something else. And that's a very exciting type of object that we don't know. So it's wonderful that one of the space agencies is considering a mission to such object. And finally, we have the two European missions. I'm not going to speak about them now because these are the topics of the next slides, but I've just listed here a few keywords that you can read maybe later if you get a copy of the slides. But I will give you all the details now in a few minutes. Yes, so before we move on to HERA and Comet Interceptor, maybe I take a very short break and ask if there are some questions.
Okay, thanks, Jean-Baptiste. So are there any questions for the speaker? Okay, we have.
Sylvie, yeah. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you, Zongyi.
Okay. So I did that in the previous the first three slides. You say we study the chemical composition. We can understand the solar the evolution, the early solar system, the Zhangjilai. But I did have a question. I need your comment because Mike Ahern published a famous paper like paper can divide the comet into two groups. One is from the chemical composition value, the ratios between the C and the C2, they can divide into the two groups. But recently, the observation for this group, I mean, they are not different. I mean, we cannot just using the information to divide these two groups. And also the Rosetta, the 6-7P, the composition in between in north and the south are also different. So do you think how we can use this information to tell us where the comet come from? I'm in the early solar system. I mean, in the Kepler paper or the where the region then where they came from in that regions.
Okay, this is an excellent question, Zongyi. And it's very difficult to answer this question too. You're perfectly right that if we only look at the composition, it's very difficult to understand the difference between comets, because overall they kind of look the same, but within the same comet we can find regions that have very different composition. It's very, very difficult to then relate this to what we think was the composition of the material at different distances from the sun. And this is even more complicated if you look at the details, because it seems like within a single comet, you can find material that was formed very far away from the sun because it needs to have been kept very cold, for instance, molecular oxygen. But you also find some clays and some materials that seem to have been heated a lot, which means they would have come from very close to the sun, where comets cannot form because the ice would not have survived there. So within a single comet, you can find material that seems to have come from different regions of the accretion disk and that all mixed together. So by only studying comets, I don't think we will be able to fully answer the question about what was the distribution of material in the accretion disk and really understand where in the disk the comets have formed. This is really, really complicated. However, I think by looking at the morphology of the comets and their impact history and their physical properties, we can constrain the collisional and dynamical environment. So this is one side of the origins that we can maybe constrain with comets and asteroids. For the composition, it's more difficult. And the best thing would maybe to go to a comet and really collect a big sample and analyze the sample. But at the moment, we don't have a mission that is going to do that.
But you say the morphology is the nuclear shape, or?
Yes, the morphology will help us. I will address this later in the talk. when I speak about comet interceptor. Maybe we can go back to this question at the end.
Okay, thank you.
So, I don't know if there are more questions.
Yeah, any other questions? If not, we can move on. No. Okay, I think maybe, I suggest we,
maybe we move on and then we get back to these sure. interesting questions later.
Yeah, sure.
So, please. On the second half of the talk, I'm going to focus on two missions in which I'm very much involved. So these are HERA and Comet Interceptor. And I think these two missions, they address many of the questions that we have discussed before about asteroid science and planetary defense on one side and about cometary science on the other side. So I will try to give you an overview of the missions without going into too many technical details. And then at the end we can discuss what it means for the community and for the future of this this planetary field. So the first mission is HERA. It's a mission that is dedicated to planetary defense and asteroid science. So HERA is actually part of a larger mission concept that we call the AIDA project, Asteroid Impact and Deflection Assessment. This is a project that was built together by ESA and NASA. And the goal of the project is to see whether we have the technological capability to change the orbit of an asteroid in order to protect the planet against a giant impact. And we think we know how to do that, or at least we have some models that show that we can do that. However, this was never tested. And because there are so many unknowns about the physical properties of asteroids, we are not completely sure that our technique would work. And if we one day end up in a situation in which we have an object that is going to impact the planet, we only get one chance to change its orbit. So we need to be sure that our models are correct. And for that, we need to test this maybe on a smaller scale, but with really realistic conditions. So how do we do that? So the plan is to impact the Didymos system. So Didymos is it's a binary system, binary asteroid system. We have two asteroids, a main one and then a smaller one. On this slide, it's still called Didymoon, I see, but the name is Dimorphos now. And the idea is that we have this system that is very stable. This one is actually not dangerous for our planet, but it's a very representative of the type of objects that could potentially impact the Earth. So NASA is going to launch a projectile at the end of November this year. And it's going to impact the small moon in this system. And this will slightly change the orbit of the moon around its primary body. We are going to observe this from the Earth because at that time, the system will be at only 0.07 astronomical units, which is only 27 times the distance between the Earth and the moon. So all the observatories in the world will be able to observe that and to observe the change of period. And from that, we will get some constraints on the efficiency of the collision and how successful we were at changing the orbit. But this is only part of the story, because to fully understand what is happening in this kind of collision, we also need to have a spacecraft there that is going to look at the crater that has been formed, at the ejecta that has been kicked out of the moon and maybe transported to the main body. We also need to understand what is the internal structure of these objects to really understand the mass actually of the system and to understand how efficient this kinetic impact, also this collision technique is. And this will be done by HERA with the European Space Agency. And so we launch a few years later and we will arrive in the system once all the debris is gone and it's a safe environment. And we will be there to really study the aftermath of the impact and study the crater and all the things I have mentioned before. So it's in the technology program of the European Space Agency. So technically, it's not a science mission. However, we are going to do a lot of science because we are going to do many things for the first time. This will be the first binary asteroid orbited by a space mission. It will be the smallest asteroid that was ever visited by a space mission. I will give you the numbers later. The first asteroid visited near the disruption limit. I will also explain what this means in a couple of slides. We will look at the cratering physics in a regime that has not really been studied before. And we will do for the first time a full tomography of an asteroid by looking inside the asteroid with a radar. That's a technology that was demonstrated with the Rosetta mission successfully. We looked through part of the comet with Rosetta and with the lander Philae. But this time we are going to really look through the full asteroid and really have a clear idea of what is the internal structure and whether there are big voids or differences in density inside the asteroid. So DART is launching next month and will impact at the end of September next year. And then in 24, we launch with RERA, and a couple of years later, we will be at the asteroid. And we are going to do a detailed investigation over many months, at least 6 months, to clearly map all the systems, so the two bodies, and measure the composition and do the tomography as I mentioned before. So why we chose a binary system to do that? First, because it's easier to measure the change of orbit of a moon around its primary body than it is to measure the change of orbit of a much bigger asteroid. So this is one of the reasons, and that's why we are targeting the moon with our projectile. The other reason is that we really don't understand much binary asteroids. They represent about 15% of the objects in the near Earth environment, but we don't really know how they form. And to give you an example, I have this figure here that shows you many of the different processes that could lead to the formation of a binary system. And we are unsure now really what process is the most likely. Maybe they are all happening together. We don't fully understand. And binary asteroids are very common, so 15% in the near Earth object population. But we also find them in the main belt and in the outer solar system as well. 67P, the comet visited by Rosetta, is a binary system. And same with comet Hartley 2, the same with actually many of the comets that we have visited before. So once again, by understanding how these objects are formed, we get some ideas about the conditions in the early solar system that led to the formation of these objects, particularly the collisional environment. I said before, this would be the smallest asteroid visited by a spacecraft. I wanted to give you an idea of the scale. So on the left, you have asteroid Ryugu that has been visited by the Hayabusa 2 mission from JAXA. And on the right, you have a representation of the Didymos system at the same scale. We know from radar observation that Didymos has a shape that is very similar to Ryugu. So that's why we have used this. So you can see that Didymos has about the same size as Ryugu, it's just slightly smaller. And Dimorphos, the moon, has the size of the largest boulder that we can find on Ryugu. And it's only 160 meters. And that's really, really small. To compare, this is the size of the Great Pyramid in Egypt. And it's also comparable to the Taipei 101 tower. Actually, the Taipei 101 is three times the size of Dimorphos. So you have to understand we are launching a spacecraft from the Earth and we are trying to impact this very, very small object. So it's going to be quite a challenge, but I think the NASA engineers who are planning the trajectory, they are very good at their job and I'm sure it will be a success. I mentioned something about the disruption limit. So one thing I didn't say before is that Didymos is very peculiar because it's rotating extremely fast. It makes one rotation in only 2.2 hours. And this is a very critical number. And I'm going to tell you why with this slide. So this is a complicated plot, but it's actually easy to understand. So on the horizontal axis, you have the size of objects. Every dot here is an asteroid. And on the vertical axis, you have the spin period. And in this region of the plot, you see that there is absolutely nothing. We don't have large objects rotating faster than 2 point something hours. We believe it is because when objects rotate too fast, they are going to break due to the centrifugal force. And that we think that this is a hard constraint due to the physical properties of the material that these asteroids are made of. And that's why we can never find an asteroid that would be spinning faster than 2.4 hours, unless it's a very, very small object. In that case, it might be just like one solid piece of rock, and then it doesn't care how fast it's spinning. But everything that would be made of many rubble pile, rocks that are just loosely tied together, would break apart if they rotate faster than 2.4 hours. And Didymos is just here on this plot. So it's really at the edge of disruption. And therefore, it's something very interesting for us to study, because we believe the surface is very unstable. So we should see a lot of movement of regolith on the surface, and maybe some avalanches and reorganization of the material. For the moon, Dimorphos, we don't know. Our best guess is that it would be here, but we are not fully sure about the rotation period. So it could be anywhere on this plot. But we believe it is in a locked rotation, so it would be somewhere around 12 hours. It's very exciting to see an object that is at this disruption limit. And the final thing I want to say about this mission is about the cratering physics. It's not the first time we try to make an artificial impact on a small body. NASA did it in 2005 with the Deep Impact mission on Comet Tempel 1. And JAXA did it with the Hayabusa 2 mission on asteroid Ryugu a few years ago. What we are going to do with DART, and that we will later investigate with HERA, if you look at the kinetic energy at the bottom of this table, we are going to have an impact that is comparable in scale to what the Americans did with Deep Impact. However, our target is 30 times smaller. So at the moment, we have many models, and it's unclear what is going to happen. We are not sure if we will really make a crater, or if we will explode completely the object, or if maybe the object will survive but will be strongly deformed by the collision. It's quite unclear because we lack important constraints on the physical properties of the material. And this we will understand better once we have completed the experiment. So to know more about the asteroid, we are flying there with the HERA mission, I said, and this is a list of the instruments that we are going to fly, the payload. So it's really the typical stuff that you find in such small mission. So we have a camera, we will have a laser altimeter to measure precisely the distance, and we have a radar to look inside the object, and a thermal infrared imager and a multispectral imager. And together with HERA, we are flying two small CubeSats that are going to complete, to give us complementary data to analyze the object. And one of these CubeSats will actually land on Dimorphos. And it has a radar. So by communicating with the main spacecraft, this is how we are going to do the tomography, by having the radar wave going from the lander to the orbiter through the asteroid. And that's what we are going to do in a few years from now. So that's for HERA. And the next mission, now switching topic, I'm going to COMET. The next mission from the European Space Agency in which I'm very much involved is Comet Interceptor. So in that case, it's not about planetary difference or not about looking at an object in our very near environment. This time it's about looking at the origins and looking at objects that are coming from the furthest away in our solar system. And the idea is to look at a dynamically new comet. What does it mean? All the previous comet missions, like Rosetta, have looked at objects that are classified as short period comets. This means objects that come back close to the sun every 5-6 years. This means their surface has experienced a lot of transformation due to the solar heating that they get every orbit. So when we study them, of course, we see some stuff that is still preserved from their original state, but most of the surface is likely to have been transformed significantly by all these evolutionary processes. And therefore, as Zongyi was asking before, it's unclear how much we learn when we only look at Jupiter family comet or short period comet. It's unclear how much we learn really about the origins of the solar system. However, if we go to a dynamically new comet, then we are going to see an object that is probably coming close to the sun for the very first time and is experiencing a bit of evolution, but it's maybe its first evolution. So maybe it's the first time it's the surface is heated by the sun. So we are going to see activity from a type of ices that cannot survive in the short period comets and are long gone. And so this is really a key element to try to understand what are the subjects made of and how they evolve the very first time they enter the inner solar system. To illustrate this, I'm going to show you here two views of two objects that look quite similar. Also, I'm cheating with the scale here. The object on the left is about it's about 6 times bigger than the object on the right. But on the left, you have Arrokos, which is a Kuiper belt object visited by New Horizons. It's a cold classical, so it means that it probably stayed where it formed early in the solar system and has not really changed since then. And on the right, you have a comet. So this was the target of Rosetta, but that's a typical Jupiter family comet. We also believe that these objects were formed in more or less the same region. So comets were formed in the same region as other Kuiper belt objects. So what we are really trying to understand is how you go from a surface like this on the left to a surface like the one on the right. And which of the features we see on the comet are actually pristine and representative of what were the conditions early in the solar system. So to understand this transition, the only way is to go to an object that is visiting the inner solar system for the first time. So this is shown in a slightly different way here. It's a slide taken from a general presentation of the mission. But it's basically the same idea. So we think that trans-Neptunian objects, they form far from the sun. They get transferred to a center orbit that brings them a bit closer to the sun until they have a close encounter with Jupiter that puts them on a very short period of orbit during which they go close to the sun every 5 years. A dynamically new comet is not following this path. It's coming far, it's living far from the sun. At some point it's disturbed and gets injected in an orbit that brings it close to the sun or to any star actually, because this can happen also in other planetary systems. And then it's going back, or it can even be ejected out of the solar system. And this is the kind of object we want to observe. So how do we do that? One problem, maybe let me get some water, please. One problem is that because they are new, we don't know these objects before the first observation. And it's not like we can observe them during a couple of orbits like we would do with the Jupiter family comets and then carefully plan how we are going to meet them in the next orbit. A dynamically new comet, we can only see it once because of the very, very long period. So we need to be able to detect these objects quite early and then send a spacecraft. But by the time we detect it, I mean, the time we have between detection and between when the spacecraft would need to meet the comet, this is too short to build the spacecraft and launch it. So this means we are going to do something a bit crazy with Comet Interceptor. I think it's the first mission to ever do that. We are going to launch without having a target. So we will launch the mission and we will wait in space at the Lagrange point L2, so which is stable compared to the Earth's orbit. And we will wait there until we detect an object. And the spacecraft is ready, it's able to wait up to 5 years. And when we detect an object that we can visit, then we are going to launch from L2, not from the Earth, but from this parking position, and go to intercept this new comet. And this means that we need a lot of support from ground-based telescopes. So all the telescopes and all the astronomers around the planet that are looking at comets to find an object. We know statistically, we find several of these long period comets per year, about one or two every year that would be suitable for the spacecraft. So we are certain that we are going to find one, that's not an issue. But once it's found, we need to characterize it as much as we can from the ground in order to plan the flyby in the best possible way. And so I think all the ground-based observers are going to be very busy with that in the years before the launch of Comet Interceptor in order to help us get ready. And in fact, many, many people in the Comet Interceptor team are ground-based observers and are going to support the mission. And Zhongyi Bin, for instance, from NCU, is a co-I on this mission, and I hope we are going to work together on that in the coming years. It's also a very small mission, and I think this is a new trend in space missions, not to have a giant big spacecraft, but instead go with multiple small spacecraft. I told you we are doing this with RERA. We have RERA plus two CubeSats. And we are doing the same with Comet Interceptor. So we have the main spacecraft that will fly by the comet from a safe distance, about 1,000 kilometers. But we have a very good camera, so we will get high resolution images, about 10 meters per pixel. But we also have two smaller spacecraft, one contributed by ESA, one contributed by JAXA. And these ones, they are able to take more risks, and they will actually try to fly much closer to the nucleus and get even better data. And because each spacecraft is going to fly with a slightly different trajectory compared to the nucleus, we are going to get multiple views of the same object from different angles. And we don't get much data because this is a very fast flyby at 50 kilometers per second, so 5-0. It's really, really fast. But because we have these multiple point observations, we are going to get a wonderful three-dimensional view of the nucleus, but also of the plasma environment, the dust environment, and all the coma and the tail of the comet. These are a few illustrations that show what I just explained before. So how we are going to wait at L2. And at some point, someone will detect a comet. We calculate the comet trajectory and calculate when it's going to cross the ecliptic. And then we launch the spacecraft or the three small spacecraft to intercept the path of the comet on the ecliptic plane and then characterize it. So I think this is very exciting, and we're going to learn a lot about this new category of objects that we don't really know much about. And to do that, we have a very well-designed suite of instruments that are partly derived. They are like smaller versions of what we are flying on the Rosetta mission. So we have, of course, a camera to take high-resolution images. We have an infrared spectrometer that covers the full range of infrared, from near-infrared all the way to the thermal range. We have, on each of the three spacecraft, we have plasma instruments electric and magnetic field instruments that are going to look at the plasma environment around the object and how the comet tail is interacting with the solar wind. That's also another side of the mission with a lot of very, very interesting deep physics, but I don't have time to speak about this in this talk. We have a mass spectrometer. This was one of the most successful instruments on the Rosetta mission. We have very similar one to the one that was flying on Rosetta, done by the same team, that is going to investigate the composition of this comet and see if it's really different from what we find in the Jupiter family comet. And then we have a complementary instrument on the second ESA spacecraft and JAXA spacecraft that provide some redundancy and also allow us to have the same kind of measurements, but from different positions. So it's I think it's going to be really exciting, a really exciting mission. So that's it for this overview of what the future will bring in terms of cometary mission and asteroid mission. And I hope that you're as excited as I am about seeing the results of this wonderful project. If you're interested in learning more about the missions, we have two websites that will give you all the details. For specific questions, I wanted to highlight my roles in this particular missions because I can address better these specific topics. So for HERA, I am responsible for the camera that will bring all the images of the two asteroids. And I'm one of the co-leads of the data analysis working group. With HERA, we intend to share all the data with all the community immediately and really work together to try to understand this object. And we coordinate this in the data analysis working group. And for Comet Interceptor, we have separated the team in the nucleus scientist, the near environment, which is cometary activity scientist, and the far environment, which are the people more looking at the tail and at all the plasma, dust, and fields. And my role, I'm the lead of the near environment working group. And so I hope to work a lot with the community on trying to understand what are the active processes on this subject, and particularly with the ground-based observer. And I'm sure with Zongyi in the coming years, we are going to plan some observing campaigns to try to understand better the activity of comets and try to find a good target for Comet Interceptor. So that's the end of my talk. To summarize, I want to say that we have at least 10 space missions that will launch in the coming decade. These are selected missions, but as I said earlier, there are also more proposals, so there will be more than that. And this means we are going to see 20 individual targets. This is as many targets, as many objects as we have seen since the beginning of the space age in asteroid and comet science. So in 10 years, we will see as much as what we have seen in the previous 50, 60 years. And with all these new missions, we are pushing the limits of our technology. And we are also going to address fundamental scientific questions about the origin of these objects, how they form, how they evolve, and how they can contribute to the life on our planet. And so I look forward to the data we are going to get on this and to all the students, young people who are listening to this talk. There will be many opportunities to participate in this missions and to work with the data. So I think that's something that you should consider maybe for doing, if you want to do a PhD or if you want to continue in planetary science. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. That's a fantastic talk. So now it's time for the questions. Okay.
Can I ask two questions?
Sure.
Okay. So for the HERA mission, so we are going to binary system. So my question is, how do we know this is a real binary system? instead of a triple or something more system, because we don't know the how do they form. And I guess because we say this is a binary system because we can resolve these two asteroids, the man and his companion. But what if you there when the spacecraft go to this system and then find the three or more, what they will do?
So two answers to that. The first one is that we have ground-based observations of the system, and we have radar observations actually of Didymos and Dimorphos. So we are quite confident that there are only two objects in the system at the moment, at least, you know, down to this scale, so 160 meters. It could be that there are a few more objects, smaller objects, maybe boulders that got ejected from Didymos that are flying around. This we don't know. And for DART, it doesn't matter because the spacecraft is going so fast and it's just going through the system and will collide with Dimorphos. But for HERA, it's something that we are considering very carefully. And when we approach the system, we are going to take a lot of observations to be sure that there is no other object flying around that could be dangerous. Because we know that there are systems with more than two asteroids. I don't remember how many, but there are a few asteroid systems with at least three bodies. Dynamically, they are not stable, so they don't survive very long. At some point, they collide with each other or one of the bodies is lost. But we know they exist. And I think there are some agencies. I think Brazil is planning a mission, a space mission to go to such object, or it was the Brazilian Space Agency. I think they were discussing that. So that's something we will consider.
Okay, but for coming to the intercept, why you didn't mention if we didn't get, I mean, from the LO2 point, because the mission then they have a lifetime. If we didn't wait the dynamic new coming, is there any backup topic for this mission?
Yes, that's a very good point. So Zongyi's question is, what happens if we are waiting there and after 5 years we have not found the target? Right? Is that your question?
Yes.
Yes. So in that case, we are limited. We cannot keep the spacecraft forever here. So in that case, we are going to launch to see another type of comet. So it would be another short period comet. But we try to select one that we have not, let's say one that has something interesting compared to the other comets. So maybe one object that has recently fragmented, for instance, where we could have the possibility to look at the interior of the comet. But this is really the backup plan. I think statistically, we are confident that we will find a target within a few years. Every year, I mean, currently with our observing capabilities, we are already able to find targets that would be suited. And with new telescopes that are being built and that will start operating in the coming years, we are very confident that we will find many more targets and we should be able to go where we want to go.
Okay, so I can see someone raised her hand from Yuening.
Yes, right? Yeah.
Yes, please.
Okay, hi Jean-Baptiste. Thank you for the great talk. So I have two related questions. The first one is about the impacting mission. So by impacting the moon, do we expect to see the main asteroid Didymos be dynamically affected? And the second one is, I don't have an intuition for the amount of energy used for this impact. What happens if the asteroid gets disrupted?
Okay, so the first question, let me go to this slide maybe. So the two objects are quite small. So I said the moon is orbiting around the main, but in reality, the two of them are orbiting around their common center of mass. And there is a little bit of wobble in this position. If we change the orbit of the moon, it's possible that we also change a bit the dynamics of the system, and that we change a bit this wobble and how the main asteroid is behaving. And maybe it could change also the orbit of the asteroid or the full system around the sun on a very long time scale. That's something we are modeling. There is a working group in the HERA mission that is dedicated to this kind of modeling, and they are really looking deep into these details. I'm not too much involved myself, so that's as much as I can tell you now, but it's a very interesting topic. And the second question is, what happens if we destroy completely the moon? I don't know, but there is something that I find very interesting and scary at the same time. I told you that Didymos is rotating very, very fast, 2.2 hours, and it's at the edge of disruption. So I wonder what will happen if we have ejecta or pieces of the moon that go collide with the main, if this is going to trigger some kind of catastrophic resurfacing, because the surface of Didymos is maybe very unstable. And so maybe this will lead to massive transformations on the surface of the main asteroid. And we will get a few images of the main asteroid before the impact. And then a few years later, when we go there with HERA, we will have many more images. So we will be able to compare and see what has changed and see whether the impact on the moon has triggered some massive changes on the main body.
Okay, thank you. And actually another question on the figure of the disruption limit that you showed, there is a wide range of size that the limiting period is independent of the size. Is there
yes.
an explanation for that?
No, it's unclear. So if we go to a few kilometers, we believe that these objects are mostly rubble piled, so that the limit that you would have up to maybe 10 kilometers is really due to the material strength. So the strength of the full body and how loosely the pieces are sticking together. If you go to larger sizes, like 100 kilometers, thousands of kilometers, then it's a really different story because the body may start to differentiate and you will have many other processes that maybe slow down the rotation and prevent the object from rotating too fast. So this the right side of the plot is a bit different story.
Okay, but for the flat part, the centrifugal forces should increase with the size, right? If we only consider the rotation
yes.
and the sticking between the material, then there should be the decrease or increase in the limiting period, no?
The centrifugal force is increasing, but it's unclear what is happening to the strength of the material. So you have a competition between the centrifugal force, the gravity of the object that is also increasing with the size.
Oh, okay.
And the strength of the material. And the strength of the material, as far as we know, is decreasing with the size. So you have a competition between these different physics.
Mm-hmm. Okay, great. Thank you. That's all of my questions.
You're welcome.
Thank you very much for the questions. Any other? Okay, I think Wenping has a question in chat box, but I think it's already been answered. Okay.
Yeah, maybe I can say something about this question. Wenping was asking, what is the likely shortest turnaround time to intercept a Oumuamua-like object? So the turnaround time is the same. Yeah, it's what I answered before. So it's the same. We only have 5 years with the mission, and we have to find an object and then intercept within the next year, basically. However, we are probably not going to Oumuamua-like object. So for people who are not familiar, this is an object that comes from completely outside the solar system. It's an interstellar object. It may be a comet that has been expelled by its own star in its planetary system and now came to our system. The problem with that is that the relative velocity of the object compared to our spacecraft would be really, really too high. Already with a dynamically new comet, we would have something like 50 kilometers per second. And that's really pushing the limits of what we can do with the instruments, because we have to take images really, really fast, otherwise they would be all blurred. And we have a very, very short time to observe. With an interstellar object, the relative velocity could be 70 kilometers per second or even higher than that. And this means it's going to be a very, very big challenge to observe. However, it's also super exciting scientifically. I mean, if we have the possibility to see an object that comes from another planetary system, it's wonderful. So if we are in this situation, I guess we will have some very difficult decision to take in the team to see whether we try to fly by this object or not. But at the moment, for technological reasons, it seems like it's unlikely that we can do it.
Okay, great. So actually I have one, I don't know, fundamental question, because for someone don't have very limited knowledge about comets and asteroids like me. So it's really hard for me to tell the difference. Like, you know, so for me, it's like they're all rocks, just, you know, with different levels or different amounts of ice or different locations, orbits or something. So is there any current consensus on what, you know, are they two different distinct objects, or, you know, they are actually the same thing?
I think you have summarized the situation very well, actually. it used to be that we would classify asteroids and comets as very different bodies, with asteroids being mostly rocky objects that are living closer to the sun, and comets are mostly icy objects that are very far from the sun. But the more we study them, the more it looks like it's a kind of continuum. And as you go further from the sun, you have objects that are more rich in ice and very volatile material. And of course, closer to the sun, you have less ice and you have more rocky elements. But we find objects in the asteroid belt that behave like comets, that have a lot of ice, that have very dark color, very exactly the same as comets. And they are active, but they used to be classified as asteroids. And on the other hand, we have objects that are following a comet orbit that should be classified as comets, but they don't show any sign of activity. And spectrally, they look like objects we see in the main belt. So it's really a spectrum of objects that are maybe not that different at the end. But it's still an open question.
Okay. So still possible there from maybe different stages when solar system evolved or different timing?
It's possible that they were formed at different times, or they were formed at different places. But it can also be that some objects were maybe comets in the past, and they have lost all their volatile material, and now they are inert. They don't show activity anymore, so we mistake them for asteroids, but in fact, they would still be comets inside. So it's there is no clear answer to your question.
Okay, still an open question. Okay,
exactly.
Okay. I'm not the only person who don't know the answer. Okay.
Oh no, you're not.
Okay, great. So any other questions for Jean-Baptiste? Okay. No. So if not, yeah, it's pretty late here. So yeah, thank you very much for the fantastic talk. It's really nice to have you here.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, I think that's the end for today's talk. And hopefully, you know, I can come back to Taiwan, we can meet in person, have more detailed discussion on comets and asteroids in the near future. Okay, great. Thanks again for everyone.
Thank you very much for having me. And I hope to come visit you in Taiwan in the maybe next year or the year after.
Yeah, merci beaucoup.
Merci beaucoup.
Okay, great. Okay, see you. Bye.
Bye, everyone.
Au revoir.
Au revoir.